Ladies, hopefully you registered for your giveaways when you came in. There's like four fun things. You can see the winners on the screen at the end of our time together today. And I thought we could start out by doing some fun stuff. I love this. I love it when we just look to Twitter for our humor, all right? So we thought we found some mom tweets, all right? And so I thought we could have a little fun here. You tell me if this is you. Let's throw these on the screen. We'll review them together. Here they are. My mom says, currently helping my son search for his chocolate that I ate last night. I don't know. Your dad did it, right? Okay, here we go. Next one. Never make eye contact with the child on the verge of falling asleep. They will sense your excitement and abort mission. Mom, is this true? All right, here we go. In church, the 9-year-old whispers, why do we have to keep sitting and standing and sitting and standing? I say, so we don't fall asleep. The 9-year-old says, oh. Listen, my goal today, mom, is to keep you and your kids awake, all right? Here we go, next one. Mom, mommy, what are you eating? Xanax. Whatever I can get my hands on right now. This lady's like, yeah, woo! All right, here we go, next one. Son, are you eating pie for breakfast? Mom says, no, it's fruit casserole. Want some? Son, no, I hate casserole, she said. I know. I'm going to eat fruit casserole on my fast this year. I'm just saying. All right, here we go. We're going to keep rolling. It says, not sure if I should be more concerned about the son who locked me out of the bedroom today or the one who showed me how to pick the lock. Y'all all got one of each, don't you? If you got two. All right. Next one, it says, my 4-year-old just shut the bathroom door on me while I was inside and told me I was in jail, so I locked the door. I love this game. How many moms, don't raise your hand, you go to the bathroom to get away from the kids, right? Where'd mom go? She's in the bathroom. She don't like you, okay? Here we go. If you wait long enough to make dinner, everyone will eat cereal. It's science. By 9 o'clock, mom, what are we having dinner? I don't know. Find something in there wearing out the Captain Crunch. Come on. Here we go. There are Olympians who began intense training regimens at age 5, but sure, son, keep licking the bathtub. I got those kids, you're like, you ever gonna grow up? This is my favorite, mom. I'm just saying, I wish I could just hear this one time in my life. Here it is. In case you were wondering, the loudest sound in the world for my kid is my kid screaming, are you pooping in the public wet restroom? Can you imagine being there, mom, are you pooping? And everybody's like, so I don't know, y'all have that kid? So all the moms are like, that's too far. It is Mother's Day, and yes, I'm the real pastor here, okay? So if you're new. So we've been in this series called Shameless, and unpacking the cycle of shame. And I want to review it because many of you are here for the first time, or you're tuning in for the first time. And I don't want you to just wonder what the background is. So we're going to kind of talk. We look at this in the book of Genesis 1, 2, and 3. Adam and Eve sinned. Shame and sin entered the world. Disobedience caused sin and shame. And they immediately ran from God and they hide because of their sin and because of their shame specifically. And so here's where shame starts. Most of us, all of us, at some point in our life, want love and acceptance. It starts as a child. I want love and acceptance. You want love and acceptance. Let's go ahead and throw this on the screen here. And so what happens is, somewhere along the way, we don't get this love and acceptance. Either we fail and somebody goes, man, I don't love you. I'm pushing you away. And it's withheld from us. People that should love us and care for us don't give it the way we feel like we need it, maybe because of their own dysfunction. Maybe you're abandoned or abused in life and you don't find yourself experiencing the love you feel like you desire. And so there's a lot of reasons this can happen. This is not a comprehensive list, but because of that need that you may not have or may not be experiencing, you now have this sense of feeling flawed. Now, I don't know about you, but whether you've done something in your life or someone's done something to you and shame enters, you feel somewhere along the way like you're not good enough and everybody can see it. And so we develop these feelings of shame and we hide. Adam and Eve hide from God in the middle of their sin, in the middle of their shame. And for most of us in this room, we fall into one of two categories. If you're watching online, you fall into one of two categories. Either A, you try harder to be perfect, because you're like, okay, I can't let this happen. Or I just say, forget it. I give up and I rebel. And so either one of those cause issues in our life, though, don't they? Because if we try harder to be perfect, we find out we can't be perfect. And so our failures continue to mount. If we decide to rebel, what happens is we go, well, I thought I wanted to rebel, but now my mistakes are mounting and I'm more ashamed. And so then the shame becomes very painful. And in the pain, we try to transfer that pain onto someone else. Many times we try to transfer the pain onto someone else by comparing ourselves or putting them down or blaming and being a victim. And we realize that doesn't solve our priority or our pain inside. And so now the anxiety continues to build. We become more and more anxious because nothing we do, nothing we try is ever enough. We try all the time to do all these things and it's never enough. So we turn finally to something to deal or to compensate with our shame. And we and because the anxiety is built and we don't feel good enough, we turn to success, to alcohol, to sex, to technology, to accomplishment, to money, whatever it may be. And the reality is if we look at this particular cycle, we've all been in it at some point. And many of us, you go, wow, I wish I could have recognized somewhere along the way that I was in this cycle and aborted. Because now I'm deep into the final stages and I'm dealing with it. And you're like, I feel like I can't get out. So here's the good news. We've been walking through this for 4 weeks now. Today we're going to end it. And my hope and my prayer is that you'll take next steps to get help, take next steps to have someone come alongside of you and navigate this journey with you. So let's talk real quickly about two types of shame. Two types of shame that we carry. Number one is this, is the shame from something that wasn't your fault. We've all experienced this, haven't we? Something that was not your fault, but yet you carry the shame. This has been a lot of our focus for the last few weeks. Last few weeks, we've talked about things like when others let you down, dealing with disappointment and how to face that. And so we've been talking about that, but I want to review it for those of you who were not here. This particular type of shame is something that you carry from maybe an experience or a moment in your life. Maybe your parents were divorced. And as a child, as a 9-year-old child, somehow you blamed it on yourself. Or you went through a rebellious stage in your teenage years, and then not long after that, your parents are divorced. Or you went off to college, and they went into debt to help pay for college or whatever, and now you look, and you're like, well, my parents got divorced because I went to college, and it caused debt. And so you feel like something you did contributed to that. Maybe you were physically or sexually abused, or you went through some kind of trauma as a child, and somehow you said, well, I deserved it. It was my fault. And somehow the enemy's got you to believe this lie. If you're a mom in the room, maybe you have experienced this situation where your child has experienced difficulties either from birth or something that happened or maybe in their teenage years, and you look inward and you carry the blame and the shame because you're like, maybe it's my fault. Maybe if I would have done better, maybe if it weren't for my sin in the past, my kid wouldn't have carried this. You carry all of this stuff, and it's what is known in psychology as this internalized blame of self. What happens is all this stuff happens around you and you internalize it, and now you take the blame for something that you had no control over. I'm going to give you another phrase. Here's what I like to call it. You won't forget this. The self-blame shame game. And that's what the enemy does. This is not your game. This is not. We have this self-blame. We internalize it. And it becomes this game that the enemy's playing with our soul and with our mind. And when he plays this game, listen, it's very deceptive, it's very dangerous, and it's very destructive. And it is a major contributor to anxiety and depression in our lives. Because we're like, I'm not, and so our heart and our emotions and our mind, and now we start playing this game, and the enemy is winning. Here's the second type of shame. We're going to talk a little bit about this today. Shame from something that was your fault. So we see this all the time. As children, we face things that happen to us, and we say, oh, we couldn't control that. That was not our fault. But then when we get older, we start making dumb decisions, don't we? And then we're like, that one's on me. Ain't no blaming nobody else. That one's on me. You can't talk me out of the fact I made that decision. I had a choice and I chose this. And what we find a lot of times when we deal with trauma and we deal with struggles in people's lives is this, that is, as a child, sometimes you look back and you see your childhood trauma and you go, wow, that's bad. I want to deal with that. But then you fast forward and deal with your adult trauma and you start going, oh, snap, that's my fault. And so what happens is when we do something that is our fault, we make a decision to disobey God, something that we could have not chosen to do. There's something that we know in theology or know in the scriptures called conviction. Now hear me. Conviction is where somewhere along, do you remember, not your first lie, because you were like two and it was like something you were doing, like I don't know how does a kid learn to lie at two? But they do, right? Your kid's lying like about stuff at two, like I didn't do that, mommy. Like I saw you do it, right? And so, but somewhere, do you remember the first time you really remember lying to your parents? And your heart was fluttering, and you're like, oh God, I'm just gonna do it anyway. Cause I don't know what the consequence. And so you lie, and then you continue to lie. Remember, You went through the cycle, and then now lying quit becoming a big deal because you became more familiar with lying than you did the conviction of the Holy Spirit. And so now lying's okay. You become a liar. Okay, remember the first time you clicked on that link? Remember when you looked at that image? Remember that time you crossed that boundary, you made that decision, you ran out? And you remember that? That's what we call conviction. The Bible says in Romans that the law of God is written upon our hearts, and the Spirit bears witness within our conscience. That's conviction. Now, all of a sudden, I'm going, okay, inside of all of us, whether we're taught right or wrong, we have an innate understanding of right or wrong because the Holy Spirit goes, hey, check yourself before you wreck yourself. That sounds like a great old 90s song, I think it was. Because this is not, we know, we've all experienced this, right? We've all come to this point in life where we're like, if I do this, then what? And we feel this conviction. Here's the thing. Conviction handled incorrectly can control you. You understand that, right? And so we have this conviction. Let me just kind of tell you what it is. It's a recognition of wrongdoing, of sin, and of failure. And you have a choice on how you're going to respond to this. If it's handled incorrectly, it'll destroy you. Now I'm convicted, and so now I'm just going to run from it and do my own thing, or I'm going to hide it and try to cover it up, and I'm going to try to make everybody believe I'm good even though I've failed. And so there's this passage in 2 Corinthians, chapter number 7. And here's what I know. There's a lot of moms that have filled with guilt and shame and don't know how to handle. Listen to what 2 Corinthians chapter 7 says. Godly sorrow brings repentance that leads to salvation. Hear me. And leaves no regret. But worldly sorrow brings death. It brings anxiety. It brings depression. It brings spiritual death. And so there's this godly sorrow that brings that brings life, but worldly sorrow that leads to shame and death and separation, and we feel this overwhelming sense because we're trying so hard to make everybody think we're okay, but we're not. But godly sorrow leads to what we know as repentance. What is repentance? It's heading in one direction. God, I realize my sin, my dysfunction. I turn, I repent, and head another direction. This is why you don't, listen, praying a prayer is not what it's all about. It's about recognizing, accepting, confessing with your mouth that Jesus Christ is Lord. Not everything over here is Lord, but Jesus is Lord. I'm turning, and now I'm beginning to follow him, okay? So let's talk about this idea of godly sorrow and worldly sorrow. Where are my good life peeps at? I need to hear you. Come on. Good life peeps, you in the house? All right. We go over a chart in the good life about halfway through about godly sorrow and worldly sorrow. And so I want to put this chart on the screen. This is not, you're going to be like, listen, don't mistake in this for going to the good life. Okay, you're like, already been, I was in that service that time. No, it's 9 weeks. We got about 2 minutes right here. All right, so the difference in godly sorrow and worldly sorrow is this. Godly sorrow is vertical. Worldly sorrow is horizontal. In other words, godly sorrow says, God, I recognize you are good in spite of my failures, that you love me, you have a plan and a purpose for my life. I confess my sins. I want help. I want to honor you in the process. Worldly sorrow is horizontal. In other words, I look around and go, I don't want people to think bad of me. I want to get this behind me. I don't want to deal with it. I'm just going to make sure everybody around me thinks I'm okay. Worldly sorrow. We feel the pressure around us versus the conviction from God. Godly sorrow is God-focused. Worldly sorrow is self-focused. One says, God, you are the center of my life. The other says, I'm the center of my life, and I want everybody to think I'm all right. Godly sorrow is spiritual. Worldly sorrow is emotional. Worldly sorrow says, oh, crap, I messed up. Got to fix it, schmooze it over, hide it, do whatever. Nuh-uh. Godly sorrow says, God, this is a real thing happening inside of me, and it's separating me from you, and I want to honor you. Godly sorrow is willing. Worldly sorrow is demanding. Now, this is where it gets real. It's supposed to be Mother's Day, and it's supposed to be a day of honor and all those things, but this could cause a little tension in some marriages, okay? So godly sorrow says, oh, I've messed up. I've disobeyed. I've dishonored God, and I've dishonored you. And listen, I want to make this right. Worldly sorrow says, hey, we've talked about it. Shut up. We dealt with it. I don't want to hear it no more. It's demanding. That's worldly sorrow. It's not godly sorrow. Godly sorrow is active. Worldly sorrow is passive. Godly sorrow is continually pursuing. That's why at Relevant Church, we say your next step is your? All right? That means we're always moving toward God because we're saying, God, we have godly sorrow. We want to move. Worldly sorrow says, I've dealt with that. Leave it alone. I don't want to. I don't want to do anything else. Just don't. It's good. It's good. We bury it. Godly sorrow is hopeful. Worldly sorrow is hopeless. Because we just read godly sorrow leads to repentance, but and life, and no regret. But worldly sorrow leads to death. Godly sorrow is grateful. Worldly sorrow is begrudging. See, when I understand that God loves me and has a plan for my life, man, I'm grateful that I can come and kneel at the feet of Jesus and make it all right. Worldly sorrow says, no, I just got to do this. I really want to be doing this, but I've been caught. It's been exposed, and so I'm going to deal with it. And it's just battle going on because you're trying to pacify the people around you other than the God that created you. A couple more. Godly sorrow is persevering. Worldly sorrow is temporary. This is why we don't just pray a prayer and go, all right, we're good. We're heading to heaven. No. Maybe. Maybe not. If you just kind of an emotional experience that's temporary versus a permanent change, it says, I'm not going to be perfect, but I'm changing. I'm turning toward God, denying myself. Godly sorrow is humble. Worldly sorrow is prideful. At the core of godly sorrow is, I am broken and I need Jesus. At the core of worldly sorrow is, I'm prideful and I need to keep everything spinning and keep everything smooth. Okay? Here's the thing, though. Forgiveness from God requires godly sorrow. And godly sorrow requires repentance, or leads to repentance, where I turn toward God. But here's the problem. And hear me, mom. If you feel like a failure, if you feel like you've struggled, young lady, maybe you're a teenager and you're going to be a mom one day and you're struggling, you're trying to figure out, you don't even feel adequate to lead yourself. Hear me. We'll never truly understand how to forgive ourselves until we understand the grace and forgiveness of God. And some of you can't forgive yourself because you don't understand the grace and forgiveness of God that He's already offered you. Now, let me just pause and apologize in advance. Because today, ladies, it's not your typical Mother's Day text from the Scriptures. Yes, I wish I could have talked about Esther or Ruth, or I wish we could have talked about Mary and Martha, or the ladies, the women who ran to the tomb to see Jesus, or some beautiful story of a woman in the Bible, but God kept bringing me back to this. So today, ladies, on Mother's Day, you get to hear about Peter. I know you're excited. I tried. I was like, come on, God, what about Esther? No. So what I want to do, the reason I want to talk to you about Peter is because I think, listen, we are all, I know we're men and we're women and we're moms and we're dads and we're single, but at the end of the day, we're human beings. And we all have this, there's something inside of us that deals with, I think, what is so prevalent in Peter's life. And so I can relate to Peter. Peter has some good qualities. But he has some blind spots. Anybody you ever feel like I'm doing good, and then you have this blind spot, it's like, pff, you do something like really like dumb. Y'all ever done that? Like, I feel like I'm doing great, and I'm like, God. So he loved Jesus, and some of you in this room are watching like, I love Jesus, but dang, I struggle. He even loved Jesus so much that he was bragging about how much he loved Jesus, right? In fact, Jesus is about to go to the cross. He's about to be arrested. And the moments before Jesus is about to be arrested, he's sitting down with Jesus at a Last Supper, and Jesus says, hey, you're going to deny me 3 times? He's like, nah, dog, I got you. Not me. Them other 11, not me. Won't be me. And he goes, yeah, you are. He gets a fair warning. You ever told your kid, if you do, don't touch the stove, it's hot? He's like, no, I'm good. Right? Because Jesus knew, and Peter's like, no, it ain't going to happen. And so now Jesus is arrested. He's being tried. He's about to go to the cross very, very shortly. And Peter's outside going, oh, snap. And somebody comes and says, do you know this man? And he goes, I don't know who Jesus is. Second time, do you know this man? He's like, I don't know who Jesus is. Third time, it gets real, y'all. Peter's warming his hands by a fire of coals. That's important. We'll come back to it. This is about an hour later. Another asserted, certainly this fellow Peter was with him, for he is a Galilean. And Peter replied, man, I don't know what you're talking about. And just as he was speaking, the rooster crowed 3 times, just like Jesus had said. Now, this is where it gets really weird. The Lord turned and looked straight at Peter. Then Peter remembered the word the Lord had spoken to him before the rooster crows today. you'll disown me three times. So Peter's like, nah, I don't know him. Now, first of all, Peter's like, I got you, dog. Put me on the cross with you. I'm good. Then he's like, nah, I don't even know the man because of fear. Nah, I don't even know the man. Nah, I don't even know the man. And about that time, Jesus goes. Now, I want you to imagine. Like, you know that time you failed and it was in secret. Nah. Imagine you failing and Jesus is like in your face. He's going to be, he's about to go to the cross and he turns and immediately goes, told you. Can you imagine the shame? Can you imagine the weight of, oh, crap, right? And in verse 61, he went outside and wept bitterly. Mommy, ever cried yourself to sleep at night? You ever put your kid on the bus and went inside and cried? You ever cried when things weren't going well in the marriage? Ladies, you're going through some stuff. But listen, man, don't check out right here because this is you too. And here's the thing. You say things like, I can't believe I did that. I can't believe I did what I did. I said what I said. I can't believe I did what I did again. I didn't do the right thing. I did the wrong thing. I'll never get past what I did. I feel so ashamed. And at that moment, the enemy has you right where he wants you. Right where he wants you. Because he knows you're at a tipping point. Addiction, masking, hiding, something to overcome the anxiety, or you turn to God in godly sorrow. Worldly sorrow, godly sorrow. And you're at that tipping point when you make that. And the enemy, write this down, shame is the devil's playground. And there are too many moms, too many women, too many young adults, too many teenagers. You're walking around with shame and you can't figure out how to get over it. And the devil is dancing on his dance floor. And so here's the difference in conviction and shame. Conviction says, I did something bad. Shame says, I am bad. See the difference? Satan uses shame to connect your actions to your identity. He wants you to feel and believe you are pathetic, you are worthless, you are hopeless, you are nothing, you are a failure, and you'll never live out God's plan and potential. You'll never fulfill your assignment. He wants you to believe that God will never bless you because of what you did, because you're a failure. And he says, I don't want you to be happy. I never want you to believe you're good enough. You're not going to have a good marriage. You're never going to make a difference. You're never going to be a good wife, a good mom, a good person, a good father. You're never going to be any of that. And he will make you believe that you will begin to believe your pain is the punishment for your past. You've been there, haven't you? I deserve this. Now, the enemy's lies to Peter are, you blew it. Jesus trusted you. You betrayed him. Jesus saw it. Did you see that look he gave you? Guys, we know what that look is, don't we? We're like, oh, snap. What'd I do to her? That look Jesus gave. All the disciples know your life is over. You'll never fulfill your assignment. You'll never fulfill your full potential. And Satan, listen to me, Satan wants to use your shame to drive you away from God. And there are too many people who struggled and battled and doubted and feared and wondered who they are and blamed themselves and lost their identity and finally said, whatever, I give up on God, I'm going to pursue myself. And the enemy is winning the battle. But God wants to use the conviction power of the Holy Spirit to draw you to His grace. I'll give you a parallel story. See, Peter wasn't the only one who turned away from God. I mean, Jesus sits down with his 12 disciples and he says, Judas, you're going to sell me out. Now, first of all, Judas wasn't really following Jesus anyway. He's stealing from him the whole time. I'll be the treasurer. Let me handle the money. Stealing from him. And then he would go and he would sell Jesus out for 30 pieces of silver to be crucified. Peter denies him. Judas sells him out. Virtually the same thing. It's denial of Jesus. It's following your own thing. But there was a difference in their response. Judas, worldly sorrow. He was caught. He was embarrassed. He was ashamed. And he ended up taking his own life because worldly sorrow leads to death. Peter, experienced a godly sorrow. He knew he was wrong. He didn't know how to respond. But that sorrow led to repentance. But Peter went through his tipping point, and ultimately he went back to his own old life. He runs from God, he hides in his shame, and he avoids anything, and he goes back to fishing. Now, this is so important because when Jesus found Peter, Peter didn't find Jesus, Jesus found Peter. What's he doing? Fishing. He does this whole miracle thing. He throws all this, he ain't caught any fish, and now all of a sudden he says, throw your net over. And Peter's like, who's this guy? I've been fishing all my life. He throws his net over, boom. He pulls in the fish. He does the miracle, and he's like, this must be the Lord. He has this encounter with Jesus, and he's like, wow, this is great. Then he denies him. He goes back to fishing. Now hear me. He goes, Jesus sets the whole stage again to go, hey, remember that last time you were in the boat? Throw your net over the side. And he re-performs the same miracle. It's like a deja vu dream. You're like, wait a second, is this real? And Peter's like, oh my goodness, it's the Lord. And he runs to Jesus on the shore. And hear me out. Jesus has done something very interesting. He has built there's a fire of coals. Only two times in the scriptures are there a fire of coals mentioned. One is when Peter's denying Jesus, warming his hands by the fire right before Jesus goes, I saw that. And the second time is when Jesus chases Peter down and builds a fire of coals and starts cooking him breakfast. And he says, come in. Peter sits down and Peter's like, last time I was at a fire of coals. Jesus is saying, I know. And he cooks him breakfast. And he says, hey, Peter, do you love me? Yeah, Jesus, I love you. Feed my sheep. In other words, finish your assignment. He says, do you love me a second time? Of course I love you, Jesus. How many times did you deny him? So you know Jesus is going to let him know, hey, I'm going to ask you a third time by the fire of coals. Do you love me? Here's my favorite part. The Bible says Peter was frustrated. Poor Peter. You ever been frustrated with God and then you really look at your life and you're like, my bad. This one ain't on you, dog. It's on me. Like, you know deep down, like you're frustrated with God, but you're really frustrated with yourself. And Peter says, do you love me? And he says, then feed my sheep. He says, I love you. In other words, what is he saying? Look to your future, not your past. So I want to give you a contrast. God creates Adam and Eve in the Garden of Eden. It's perfect. It's beautiful. It's where we started this series. Adam and Eve sin. The Bible says they were naked and they felt no shame. And then sin enters the world. And immediately they're like, you ain't got no clothes on. What are clothes? I don't know. But you naked. You naked too. Uh-oh. I mean, it's weird. It's really like they didn't even, impurity, dysfunctional thoughts. So they hide. They hide in their sin. And they hide because they're shameful. The brokenness of humanity is revealed in that moment. And in their hiding, guess what happens? God comes looking. And he has a conversation. Yo, where you at? I know this is not the King James Version, all right? And Adam's like, we was afraid because we naked and we was ashamed. Well, who told you were naked? That's a great question. I don't know. We just figured it out. So he sows fig leaves. Remember, he has to kill the animal. No death has entered the world until then. So he kills the animal, makes fig leaves. This is foreshadowing of Jesus' life, death, burial, and resurrection, the blood sacrifice that would pay for your sins and for mine. But God comes and has a conversation. And then Peter, he goes back to his old life. He's on a boat. He's doing his own thing, hiding in his shame, going back to his father's business. And here comes Jesus. Guess what he wants to do? Have a conversation. You ran from God. You messed up. I get it, he says. You can't forgive yourself, and you think God is angry and frustrated and over you. And Jesus says, no, 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 come to me. He's not mad at you. He wants you to come to him so much so that he came to you in this dirt ball called earth. The God, the Son of God, incarnate in the flesh, became flesh and dwelt among us and did not sin, but took your sin and your shame on his back, put it on a cross, was put in a tomb, and was resurrected so you could be free. And 1 John 1:9 says this, Mom, young lady, Dad, doesn't matter. If we confess our sins, He is faithful and just to forgive us of our sins and purify us from all unrighteousness. And the glory of that statement is that when you receive the forgiveness of God, you can forgive yourself. All the lust, all the lies, all the deceit, all the cheating, all the neglect, all the bad decisions, all the words, all the stuff, all the addictions, all of that, Jesus is simply saying, come to me. Don't run from me. Let's have a conversation. We can work through it. We can get through this together. You're my brother in Christ. You're my sister in Christ. We are joint heirs with this thing called eternity in heaven. Don't you run. Let's have a conversation. For some of you, it's been far too long. I mean, we mumble weak prayers because we're teaching our kids, right? Hey, rub-a-dub-dub, thanks for the grub. Bless the meat, Lord, let's eat. And your kids hear you praying for them at those moments. You have to, but they don't see you praying in your own life because you don't feel like close to God. You just want to make them something you weren't. You want them to talk to Jesus, but you never talk to Jesus because you feel so dysfunctional. You feel so inadequate. You just want your kids on the journey to heaven, but you don't know if you're going. And Jesus is simple. I came to you. Come to me. Don't let your past determine your future. Don't let shame, don't let the devil dance on your tomb. Be free, because whom the Son sets free is free indeed. Mom! Finish your assignment. Live out your purpose. You are fearfully and wonderfully made. And yes, you might have screwed it up. We all have. But that's the joy of Jesus. And so, you say, man, I don't even know how to do it as a mom or as a dad. I don't know. I feel so distant from Jesus. Just start where you are. And so we're going to sing a song. And during the song, just stick around to the end. Let the song speak to you. Wherever you're at in this song, whatever phase, there's about 3 or 4 or 5 phases here, and you're going to be, that's where I'm at. Oh, that's where I'm at. Just know, if you don't deal with it, it's Mother's Day, so I'm going to say this to moms, but everybody will hear it. That's what I love about Mother's Day, is the men go, crap, he's talking to me too. Listen, get this right for you, but also get it right for future generations. Your kids and your grandkids and your great-grandkids, deal with your stuff. But it starts with a conversation with the God of the universe. Would you close your eyes right now? If you're in this room right now, let the Holy Spirit of God convict your heart, and we're going to respond to Him on it. God, I pray during this moment in this song, You would illuminate our lives, illuminate our dysfunction, and build our faith and our trust, knowing that You are good and Your purposes for our life are not done. Help us to finish our assignments, to live out our calling, and understand the grace of God in our lives so that we can forgive ourselves and be free of this shame. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen.
Grandma used to pray out loud by her bed every night. To me it sounded like mumbling, like she was out of her mind. She said, boy, this kind of praying is what saved my life. You ought to try it sometime. Now I know she was right, 'cause she was talking to Jesus. She was talking to Jesus. She'd be talking to Jesus for all of her life. Mama used to drag me to church Sunday mornings and Wednesday nights. Khaki pants and a polo shirt, boy, I put up a fight. She said, son, one day you thank me for having God in your life. And yeah, I know she was right. Yeah, my mama was right, 'cause now I'm talking to Jesus. She got me talking to Jesus. She got me talking to Jesus for the rest of my life. And what a friend we have in Jesus. What a friend we have in Jesus. What a friend we have in Jesus. Whoa. I've got three of my own, trying to raise them up right. My oldest is 15, and I remember what that was like. Trying to deal with the drama, trying to figure out the questions in life. I've been looking for a way to show him how to make it all. And he walked in my room while I was saying my prayers the other night. He said, I'll come back later, I can tell you got a lot on your mind. I said, it's not an interruption, you couldn't have picked a better time. 'Cause I was talking to Jesus, come over and give it a try. We started talking to Jesus, we started talking to Jesus. And I hope he's talking to Jesus for the rest of his life. And what a friend we have in Jesus. What a friend we have in Jesus. What a friend we have in Jesus. Whoa. There's no wrong thing to do it. There's no bad time to start. It don't have to sound pretty, just tell them what's on your heart. 'Cause it's not a religion, 'cause it's more like a friendship. Just to talk to your father like you are his kid. So start talking to Jesus. Just start talking to Jesus. You can talk to Jesus whenever you arrive. Just start talking to Jesus. Just start talking to Jesus. Just keep talking to Jesus for the rest of your life. Just talk to Jesus. Just talk to Jesus. Use your own words to talk to Jesus. Just talk to Jesus. Would you just praise him? See, what a friend we have in Jesus. What a friend we have in Jesus. What a friend we have in Jesus. Whoa. What a friend we have in Jesus. What a friend. friend we have in Jesus.
So good to know that no matter how much you feel regret, remorse, you struggle with addiction, you've betrayed your spouse, you feel like you've let God down, let others down, let yourself down, let your family down, that Jesus and God the Father are still crazy about you. I love this passage in Philippians 1:6, and this is what I hope you'll believe today. Paul says, being confident of this, that he who began a good work in you will carry it on to completion until the day of Christ Jesus. So here, you want to know who stood up when the church started 2,000 years ago on the day of Pentecost? Peter. Because he had a purpose. He fulfilled his assignment. Hear me. Forgiveness doesn't change your past. It frees you for a better future. Now listen, he washes you clean. He makes you new. It's like it never happened. But you can't go back and undo it. You can't go back and change it. But what you can do is live free from it and look forward to a better future. And so my prayer is that you receive God's forgiveness today so that you can forgive yourself and live free of shame. Man, what a powerful message in this series. And I love that in Genesis, when it all hit the fan, God knew shame was going to play a part. And Jesus bore and scorned our shame on that cross. I want you to close your eyes. Maybe if you're watching online, I want you to respond in your own way. Let us know in the chat or let us know in a private message. But you're here today. Nobody's looking around. You say, I'm not a follower of Jesus. I haven't received the forgiveness of God in my own life. I'm still following my sins, following my desires, and I want to turn from God, and I want my life to follow him. I want to repent of my sins, godly sorrow, not worldly sorrow, not because you got caught, but because you want to pursue the God that loves you so much. When nobody looking around, you want to join with a half a dozen other people today who've made that decision. When I say three, lift your hands, put it in the chat, or let us know online. Come on. Right where you're at. 1, 2, 3. Hands up all across. Come on. Lift them up high. Yeah, yeah. Yeah, somebody else. Come on. I'm just going to wait a minute. I see hands. Yeah, all the way up top. Yeah, wow. If that's you, I want you to whisper these words to God. Dear God, I believe you sent Jesus to die on the cross for my sins. He lived a sinless life. He took my sins upon his back and nailed them to that cross and defeated death, hell, and the grave. Today, I ask that you forgive me, that you would be Lord of my life, that you'd help me live for you from this day forward. Thank you for saving me today. Today I call you my Savior, and I call you my Lord. In Jesus' name. Now, if you're here in this room, or if you're online, and you feel like, man, I need to forgive myself. I need to embrace the grace of God so that I can forgive myself and be free of this shame all across. Let's lift our hands as we pray. Come on, all across. I know, man, there's so many of us that struggle with this. I deal with it all the time. Come on, shame from the past. You need to forgive yourself. Come on, lift your hands. Let us join together. Right now, God, you see the hands of every single person in this room. Help us to go on the journey to do hard things. Lord, help us to embrace and receive your forgiveness and then move forward in freedom today, forgiving ourselves. I pray we'd walk out of here different than when we came in. If we need to get in the good life or counseling or some sort of support group today, I pray you give us the courage to do it so that we can love ourselves the way you love us, see ourselves the way you see us, and forgive ourselves the way you forgive us. Thank you for loving us. Thank you for the women in our lives, the moms, the wives, the people who change our lives so much and do so much. Bless them today. Encourage them today. And if their mom's here dealing with shame, help them to know, God, they are fearfully and wonderfully made. It's in Jesus' name we pray. And everybody said, amen. Come on, thank God for his love. Put your hands together for these people who just lifted their hands.